Good morning and welcome to the Pastor's Corner. This is your host, Pastor Wayne Baker, bringing you the Pastor's Corner. We believe to be the inspired word of God. Good morning again. Get on the phone and tell your friends, loved ones, family members that the Pastor's Corner is on the air. This morning we're going to study Genesis, the 6th chapter and the 8th through the 9th verse. 8th through the 10th verse, pardon me. And so these are the verses we're going to study this morning. First, a word of prayer. Father, we thank you for the audience who are about to hear this word. And we thank you for your loving kindness and your tender mercy. Bless in Jesus' name. Amen. I want to talk this morning about Noah's three sons. So we're dealing with the race, you see. And it is important for a Christian not to have any racial tendencies. No gender tendencies as far as prejudice or dislike for the genders. And no prejudice, period. Even among homosexuals, gay, lesbian people, we're not to harbor any prejudice. You see, we are the people of God, and we accept people as they are. And one of the things now in America is that there is a mean spirit throughout this country. So let's get with it and let's look at each individual purpose the way God looks at them. In the image of God, He made male and female. In the image of God, He made every person. There is no such thing in the Bible as race. The word is simply not used for race. There's no word, designation for the Bible as race. So then, the Bible says in Genesis 6th chapter and the 8th verse, but Noah found grace in the eyes of the Lord. These are the generations of Noah. Noah was a just man and perfect in his generations. Noah walked with God. And Noah begat three sons, Shem, Ham, and Japheth. We're going to stop there. We're going to deal with this. He begat three sons, Shem, Ham, and Japheth. But first I want you to see the importance of three. Almost all things begin with three. You can take a sermon, put it in three parts. Every sermon basically has three parts by expository preachers. The atom made up of the nucleus, the proton, the electron, and the neutron. And so it is, solid, liquid, gas, what have you. And even the Holy Trinity, Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Now, three is very significant. So he had three sons, and I believe that represents the Trinity. But each one of these sons had different roles that they were to perform. For example, why is there a Trinity? Wouldn't it be enough to have one God, which we do? This is not modernism. I'm saying the Father, the Son, and Holy Ghost. This means that they had perfect intercourse with one another before the world began. Well, Jane Weldon Johnson is wrong in his creation poem. The Father was not lonely. It says in that poem, God said, I'm lonely, so I'll make me a man. God was never lonely on this earth, in heaven, or anywhere else. But he did it to bring man into fellowship with him. The role of the Father simply is creator. He is the creator of all things. And the Holy Spirit is the worker. And the Son is the redeemer. Now we find the role of the Holy Spirit. In Genesis 1, the Bible said, the Spirit moved upon the water. Here we see the Holy Spirit bringing order out of chaos. And then we have the Father. Jesus said, I work and my Father work, but we are one. And the Son, who is the Redeemer of mankind. Jesus so loved us. The Father so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. So in that we see that that there are three different distinct personalities in the Godhead, but only one God. That is three distinct personalities subsisting in one Godhead, and each with different personalities and different roles, but they overlap, you see, and sometimes the Father, the Son, the Holy Ghost is different. It's difficult to tell which one is speaking. We have the three sons of Noah. Now, many Bible scholars believe that Noah had triplets. Mrs. Noah had triplets because nowhere else in the Bible does it say that someone, three persons was born at one time without giving the year of designation. Like in the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord. It's a notation there, so we would know what happened in this event and with this event. But here it says that Noah had triplets. Of course, this is Mother Noah, as we know. And so Shem, Ham, and Japheth is the order. Now, there was an order in creation for each one of these brothers. Let's look at the contribution of Shem. Shem's contribution to this world was basically religious. He had the priesthood. From Shem came Abraham. From Abraham came Jesus Christ and the 12 tribes of Israel, as you well know in the Bible. So his purpose was as a priest between the other two brothers. His purpose on the earth was to reconcile the whole world unto the Savior that would come out of Abraham's loins. And so out of all the brothers, Shem is yet to do his job. Shem is yet to do his job. And so Israel failed, but Israel also had religion. Their greatest contribution was in religion, Judaism. The father of Judaism. And you know, Judaism is not considered a main religion now. We Christians believe Judaism has yet to be fulfilled in Christianity. Judaism is the first step in God's fulfillment of Christianity. And then Christianity, we take as true religion. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but may in him have an everlasting life. So the Semites, Shem's descendants, are the father of both true religion and false religion. What other religion did the sons of Shem invent or create? They had Islam. Now Islam, as us Christians take it, is not a true religion. And it only started about 640 AD through Muhammad ibn Abdullah. It started on the Arabian continent, quickly spread to the African continent, then went up in Europe. All of these had a civilizing effect and prompted Christianity, although Christianity started with Christ over 600-700 years earlier, and Judaism had been around as a religion for about 3,500 years. So these are the contributions of the sons of Shem. Now Japheth, another son of Noah, was to spread out. The Bible says, God said, I will enlarge Japheth. Well, this enlargement came basically at the expense of Shem and Ham. Who are the Japhetic people? Japhetic people are the Europeans in the far north and places like Europe. But the thing that puzzles many historians and many anthropologists is that Finland they look like Europeans, they are Europeans, but then they speak an Hamitic language, which tells us that race and race designation is not always in a certain region, because the Finns speak an Hamitic language. And so we know that Ham was up there. And at one time, the whole world was of a dark hue, you see. And so the Japhetic contribution came at the expense of Ham and at the expense of Shem, basically around 1300 to 1400 AD, the European began to rise. Now they rose earlier through Alexander, the so-called great, and Julius Caesar and the Romans. But in later, the Europeans went through what is called a Dark Age, and the Moors from the south came up and educated Europeans, and so they took off. They took off with colonization, they colonized the world, and that was the enlargement that came at the expense of Ham. Now, Japheth's purpose was to spread out. He was to take the civilization of Ham and spread out through all the world. In other words, Shem got out first. Shem got out in the 12th chapter of Genesis. And so as he got out with Abraham, through Father Abraham, the seed of that came through Abraham, Christ being the seed, through Father Abraham. And so Ham civilized the world, and Japheth was to take the civilization that Ham produced to all of the world. That was Japheth's purpose. And you see, Japheth has done his job, Ham has done his job, only one brother left to do his job, and that is Shem. Now the Bible says that in the last day, Israel will do her job. The 144,000 Jewish witnesses will witness during that time, and basically Israel is cut off now, but they will be drafted in later on. Now let's come to the civilization of Ham. Ham was the most prolific son that Noah had. In other words, Ham's job was simple, to take and civilize the world. And every civilization has its root in Ham civilization. The Himyaritic civilization in Arabia, the Olmec civilization in Central America, the Egyptian civilization in Africa, the Kushite civilization in Africa, the Stonehenge civilization in Europe, all of these were Hamitic civilization, even Babylon. We can go to the 11th chapter of Genesis, and we see that Babel was the beginning of Cush kingdom. Now Cush in the Bible means black, a black man. And so Cush, that word is wrongly interpreted as Ethiopia. There's no such word in the Bible as Ethiopia. It's Cush, meaning black. And so surrounding that area was nothing but civilization. Civilization had not yet reached Europe as of yet. It would eventually reach Europe because, see, God is no respecter of person. That's one thing we got to see about God. Why did God use these three brothers? He used them because life is a trinity, you see. Ham, the civilizer. Shem, the evangelizer. And Japheth, the conqueror. And so we have now, basically the whole world has been influenced by European domination, but Europeans took the civilization that Ham originally established to the end of the world. The first person out was a son of Ham named Mizraim. Mizraim in the Bible. This word is wrongly translated Egypt. There's no such word as Egypt in the Bible. It's Mizraim. And some of the time I believe that these words are confusing to throw people off as to their ethnicity, you see. But Mizraim, Philistine, and Kazarim, all of these were sons of Mizraim. They created the Great Pyramids, which is a construct within itself. So in that year, Mother Noah and Father Noah, they had triplets, Shem, Ham, and Japheth. Now, the thing about this is not who did what. I'm not denoting that. I'm not concentrating on who did what. My concentration is on the purpose. You see, everyone in life has a purpose. And how well you do in life, the grace you get with God and the reward you get will be based on how well you have fulfilled the purpose which God has given you. Purpose is the intent of the thing. It is the destination of the thing. It is what the thing was meant to be. And so we have the three brothers fulfilling their purpose and destiny. Race is not mentioned in the Bible, but race has become prevalent ever since Constantine conquered this folk that he was praying to God for a sign. God gave him the sign, and he ushered in 50% of his kingdom of Rome became Christians. And before that, it was only 10%. That makes us realize people, the government and Christianity do not mix one bit. As long as government is controlling Christianity and Christianity is controlling government, there will always be problems. The early fathers believed in justice for all men. The early fathers did not believe in war per se. The early fathers did not even believe in just wars. They believed that they had it, and it was Christianity, and they set out to set the world on fire. When they met at the day of Pentecost, there were Parthians there from Iran. Africans were there from Cyrene and Egypt and Libya. And I suppose some Europeans were there from Turkey and other parts of the world. But God wanted his salvific purposes to be fulfilled in these three brothers, particularly through Shem, Noah's first son. So the importance of the three is very important, you see. Three is the number of God. This three is significant because it represents the Holy Trinity. The role of the Father is a creator. The role of the Holy Spirit is a worker. And the role of Jesus is a redeemer. So Noah's three sons produced the whole world. The whole world was populated through the sons of Noah. So there is no racial superiority for any of these people. There's anyone that thinks that there is a certain race that's superior to another is an absolute fool. He is crazy, he is sick, and he is demonic. Jesus called his church. Church means, come from a Greek word, ekklesia, and it means theologically called out ones. Those who have been called out of this world, those who have been called out of a system of things, those who have been called out of evil unto God's marvelous light. And so we need to be careful about racism. Racism has been more destructive than all the evils of this world combined together, mixed with religion, racism. So the problem, I agree with W.E.B. Du Bois, of the 20th century is a problem of race. Now, watch this word up here in the 6th chapter and the 8th verse. Noah found grace in the sight of the Lord even before Shem, Ham, and Japheth were born. He found grace in the sight of the Lord. Grace means something that God gives to you on his behalf. And I know we think that grace is something free that God gives you. Free it is. But in a higher sense, grace is what God gives to you to work on his behalf. And so God gave the world Shem, Ham, and Japheth. They're all men. They were all equal. They all came out the womb, I believe, at the same time, though some theologians might disagree with me. They're all mere men. One is not superior to the other. And next week, I'm going to deal with the curse of Ham. I want to show you that God did not curse Ham, that this is myth, it's biblical mythology. And so during that time, you had three sons born. Now, in Genesis, the 10th chapter, speeding up to the 9th chapter, the boys come out of the ark. They all had their wives. All of them had distinct personalities. You see, God uses your personality for his purpose. You see, everybody in the church cannot preach, but everybody cannot pray the same way. But everybody in church can achieve his purpose, which God gave to him or to her to achieve. And so this would make all one. The head can't say to the hand, I have no need of you. The hand can't say to the feet, I have no need of you. We're all one in Christ Jesus. And when the world learned this, when we learned this in Christendom, when we learn it in the church, when we learn it in denominationalism, things will begin to get better. I fear it won't, though. Things are going to get progressively or regressively worse because we have established too many things that divide us rather than those things that attract and bring us together. Now, after the flood, Shem, Ham, and Japheth, they come out, and the Bible in Genesis 10th chapter gives the table of nations. And so all of them had distinct personalities. But at the Tower of Babel, we see in the 11th chapter of Genesis, they were all together in one place. Now, this was not God's original plan. God told them to scatter about the earth and to replenish the earth and fulfill the earth, get people in there. Everywhere you go, colonize. I'm not talking about European colonization, but they were to attract people and teach them the ways of God. Instead, they built a tower called Babel, Tower of Babel. You've heard about it in Genesis 11. The Bible says they were of one speech and one language, and they had one mind. And you see, racial differentiation had not started at that time. But the Bible says, God said, unless we go down, they will be able to do this. In other words, they were not trying to build a tower literally in the heaven. They couldn't do that because they would run out of oxygen and they would die. What they wanted to do was to thwart God's plan for them to scatter out. And they wanted to build the tower of Babylon as a rallying point when the flood came, if God decided that he would destroy the earth again. Well, perhaps they didn't listen to Father Noah. God's covenant with him is that he would never destroy the earth again because Noah found grace in the sight of the Lord. So God scattered them. Now, keep in mind, they were of one mind. They were of one spirit. They had one goal at that time. They were like-minded. They had one language. Geneticists and etymologists said that at one time all men were the same. And they also said that they could trace the language to one single language in the beginning. But they were together and they had one tongue. And God said, unless we go down and change their language, they will be able to do whatever they want to do. I argued vehemently against a professor when I was in seminary that I don't believe that man could do anything. He said, Baker, believe it. The Bible says what it means, and it means what it says. So I don't doubt that particularly. But race and race designation had not started up until then. But afterward, the European went north. The Hamite went south, and the Asian stayed in the middle, what is now called, unfortunately designated as the Middle East, Arabia, Iraq, and around that area. Shem's name means dusky, and the mulatto people came from Shem. Ham's name means dog. Black folks and Africans came from Ham. And European, Japheth name means, Japheth was a albino, so his descendants went north. Albinos at that time had not developed the capacity to live in a hot climate or to live in places where the heat was and the sun was shining. So they went north, and it wasn't until later on their eyes developed and this happened to them, and they were able to come back down and get languages and stuff from people in the Southland. They were educated basically by the African and by the Asians, and as education went north, now it's going south, you see. God made us dependent men, we're dependent on one another. And so God gave these three boys, I will call them, the education and the wherewithal to achieve their purpose. Now, later on, the son of Shem, we know as Jesus Christ, would come and he would save the world. And he would save it through himself. God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but may in him have everlasting life. Beloved, I think we will close here today, and I want to thank you for watching the Pastor's Corner. Our doors are open to you every Sunday at 10 a.m. Please come to visit our church. We have something for everyone. And by the way, this Sunday, as you go to your church, I want you to go up to your pastor, thank him for the services he gives to you. Just like a soldier, when you see him, thank you for your service. Well, us pastors, we are the least appreciated. So why don't you thank him for his service that he gives to you. Again, I'm Pastor Wayne Baker from the Pastor's Corner saying so long. And I'll see you again next week.